I am thankful for that, and thankful for the beautiful sunshine that he's given us this evening, and sounds like all weekend long we have to look forward to, so praise the Lord for that. We're going to get ready and take communion together now at this time, and the way we're going to do it is we're going to have Bob and Brenda come up, and they're going to, if you can, pass around. They're going to give you the elements. You'll hold out your hand, they'll put the bread in the palm of your hand. They're going to have gloves on, then they'll hand you a cup. The other one will, they'll have a glove on, and you can go return to your seats. If you cannot come up front, then they will bring it back to you. After everyone's passed through, just raise your hand and they'll bring it right back to you, and then we will all take it together. So let's have a word of prayer, and then we'll have them come, and I'll just ask you to pass. If you want to start over on the, I guess, this side over here and work your way around. Father, we thank you for your love and blessings. Thank you, Father, for your Holy Spirit, Lord, and for the great message that we have heard, Lord, in all of the songs this evening, Father, and just of your great love for us. And Lord, as we prepare our hearts, Lord, to remember the price that you paid, Lord, for our sins, we just pray, Lord, just help us, Lord, to see you, Lord, and to recognize the great cost that it costs, Lord, for you to send your only Son, Jesus, to come to the cross for us. And Father, we thank you for that price. Help us, Lord, to live, Lord, and to realize that we are bought with a price, that we might live our lives for you. Thank you, Jesus. We ask this in your name. Amen. Thank you. When the hour had come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him. And then he said to them, "With fervent desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I will no longer eat of it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Then he took the cup and gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And he took the bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." You know, I thought as you think of Jesus' body broken for us on the cross and how he had to suffer. It wasn't just the cross, but he had went out with the disciples into the garden and then he ends up going through the longest night of his life. And as we are celebrating this together, it would have been, looking back in history, if you would go back to that Friday, it would be, at this point, he would be in the tomb. And as you think about that, it's just so wonderful to think that he would do that for you and for me. "Likewise, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you.'" And we know right after this in the gospel account that Jesus looks around the table and he says, "One of you will betray me." And I have to think of how heart-wrenching that was for him to think that one of these men who had been with him so intimately over that period of time would be willing to betray him. But Jesus, as always, was totally in control. And as we had talked about how he had set his face towards Jerusalem and how that he was going to bring it about exactly in the time that God would have it to be brought about. You know, when Judas was thinking about betraying Jesus, Judas and the religious leaders, they had said, "Hey, we're not going to do it on the feast day because we don't want to take a chance with all the people being in Jerusalem. The city is packed. We don't want to take a chance with there being a riot in the city." And Jesus, you know, kind of destroyed their plans, because when he looks around the table and says, "One of you is going to betray me," and then he looks right at Judas and says, "What you've got to do, you go ahead and do it right now." Judas now knows, hey, I cannot wait. If I'm going to do this deed and betray Jesus, I have to do it tonight. And so he set the whole thing in motion. He controlled the outcome. He controlled every moment of him going to the cross. And when you think about that, it's like he was in control and everyone else was kind of a player in the story, and they thought they were in control, trying to be, and yet it was just unfolding exactly the way that he wanted it to unfold. And so he spent that long night, and up all night long. I've been up all night sometimes working third trick, you know, and I never was a good all-night person. I would come home from third trick, and I would sleep, and I would get up, and I was still tired. And I'd go back to work, and I'd do the same thing. Some people love third trick. My body just did not ever seem to adjust to it when I was on it. But he was up all night after teaching and ministering to the disciples around the table. They go out into the Garden of Gethsemane, and he's praying intensely. You know the story. Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. And then Judas comes with the mob, and they take Jesus, arrest him, and he's up all night going from one place to another. He's, you know, once he declares that he is the Messiah to them, because he tells the high priest, you're going to see me coming in the clouds of glory. Then the high priest, at that point, they're ready to do him in. You know, they were looking for any excuse, and when he said that, that's the excuse they took. And so then they start to abuse him verbally and physically, and eventually take him in front of Pilate. And you know the story from the scriptures. Pilate tries everything he can as a politician to escape the situation, but he's cornered, and finally he passes judgment, crucify him. And Jesus goes to the cross. And so that's where we're going to pick up in the scriptures this evening. Luke 23, verses 32 through 34. Luke 23, verses 32 through 34. It says, there were also two others, criminals, led with him to be put to death. And when they had come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified him. And the criminals, one on the right hand and one on the left. Then Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. And they divided his garments and cast lots. And so Jesus is sent out to this place called Calvary, but not alone. He's got two other individuals with him. They are both criminals. We know from other scripture that they were thieves. And so they're getting their just dues under the Roman law. And of course, Pilate, we know he washes his hands. He doesn't find any fault with Jesus, but yet he condemns him to death by the cross anyway. And so Jesus goes to the cross. And what I love is look at what it says there at the very end. Jesus said, Father, forgive them. For they do not know what they do. And they divided his garments and cast lots. And you and I, sometimes we have trouble forgiving people, don't we? Isn't it sometimes hard for us? Someone just does something or says something and we're kind of offended by it. And sometimes people really do things to you that maybe really are really hurtful. You know, and it's very difficult to get past those situations. But here is Jesus. He gets nailed to the cross, and his words are, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. Think about that. Just let that kind of soak in. And particularly if you've got something in your heart this evening that you have been holding on to, some unforgiveness, and it may be unforgiveness, somebody's done something and they really were wrong, but yet when we don't forgive, it hurts us far more than it hurts the other person. It just tears us up inside. It just does all kinds of things to our hearts and our minds and separates us from the love of God. And so Jesus sets this example as he is nailed to the cross. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. And it says they divided his garments and cast lots. That seems pretty heartless, doesn't it? But the Roman soldiers, these guys, they were used to crucifying people, the ones that were sent out there. They did this kind of work. It was bad, but they were in a Roman soldier, and so they were used to it, and so they were getting their mind off of it. They were gambling over his clothes. According to the scripture, he fulfills all the scripture, and they're gambling for his garments. And we know from Psalms that that was something that was prophesied that they would do. And here he is, the very Son of God, nailed to the cross, and yet at this point in time, these individuals, their hearts are hard. And they're just focusing on what can we get out of this? How can we pass the time? And sometimes we as individuals get in that kind of a hard-hearted state in that we don't really embrace and understand who Jesus is, and we're just kind of passing the time. But when we really kind of focus on who Jesus is and we really understand his great love for us, then that helps us to get past those moments of thoughtlessness that they were having at that point and start to focus on the love of God. And when we get there, that's a really good place. Verses 35 through 38 says, "And the people stood looking on, but even the rulers with them sneered, saying, 'He saved others. Let him save himself if he is the Christ, the chosen of God.' The soldiers also mocked him, coming and offering him sour wine, and saying, 'If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself.' And an inscription also was written over him in letters of Greek, Latin, and Hebrew, 'This is the King of the Jews.'" And so this is a sight that is not hidden. The Apostle Paul says it wasn't done in a corner, but Jesus is out in front. He's been this celebrity we just talked about last week when the city was packed and he comes into the city. Who is he? Who's this man? What's going on? And so that's happened throughout the week. He's still been ministering throughout the week. And here he ends up on the cross and there are people there. They wanted to come out and see the end. And of course, the religious leaders, they wanted to see the end also. And they start to mock him. And that's a hard thing for us, isn't it? It's hard for me to think about Jesus being mocked by somebody. You know, isn't that hard for you to think about that? When you know the love of Jesus and you've experienced the love of Jesus and he's in your heart, to think about someone mocking him. But sometimes people do it today and maybe not even really thinking about it, but they will mock Jesus. They'll mock people who believe in Jesus. Here he was on the cross and the religious leaders, they are mocking him. He saved others, they say, let him save himself if he is the Christ, the chosen of God. The soldiers, they're also mocking him right now, offering him sour wine to drink, saying, if you're the king of the Jews, save yourself. And I love it because it tells us that the inscription was put up above him, which said, this is the king of the Jews. Now, this was not the religious leader's idea. We know from other scripture that Pilate puts it up there. This is the king of the Jews. Because, man, Pilate got forced into this. He didn't want to do it, but they had him. And he had to go along with the crowd, he felt like. And so, but this is one thing they go and say, hey, we don't want you to put he is king of the Jews. We want you to put he said he's the king of the Jews. Pilate has taken all he will take at this point. He says, what I've written, I have written. And I love it because that is the testimony. He rode into the city last week proclaiming who he was. He's dying on the cross now on Friday. And up above him, it says who he is. He is the king of the Jews. And for you and me as Christians today, we believe he is our king and that he has brought us into the family of God. And so it, even though it was done, maybe some people might have thought heartlessly, and yet it was a statement that was so true. Here he is, the king of the Jews, dying for you and for me, showing the love of God in the flesh. Verses 39 through 43 says, "Then one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed him, saying, 'If you are the Christ, save yourself and us.' But the other answering rebuked him, saying, 'Do you not even fear God, seeing you are under the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong.' Then he said to Jesus, 'Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom.' And Jesus said to him, 'Assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise.'" And so even one of the criminals takes up the same kind of talk to Jesus. And he says, if you're the Christ, save yourself and us. But he wasn't repentant. This thief wasn't repentant. He wasn't sorry that he was a thief. He was just saying, if you are the Christ, get me off this cross. That was basically his plea at the moment. And sometimes we're like that. Sometimes people bargain with God. Have you ever bargained with God? Hey, if you get me out of this situation, then, Lord, I'll serve you. You know, they call that foxhole Christianity. You know, people who've been in the military sometimes have made promises to God. You get me back home, I'm going to serve you. But then they get out of the foxhole and they get back home, and sometimes they don't follow through with that promise. This particular individual, he just was like, hey, if you are the Christ, save yourself and us. But that couldn't be done. Jesus could not save them and himself from suffering. Price had to be paid for the sins of mankind. If Jesus had saved himself, he couldn't have saved us. So he had to offer himself on the cross for your sins and mine. And salvation was available for this criminal if he would have been like the other criminal on the other side of Jesus. Because he says, do you not even fear God, seeing you're under the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds, But this man has done nothing wrong. The other criminal, he recognizes, hey, I have sinned. I have messed up. And he calls out to Jesus. He recognizes who Jesus is. And he says, remember me. And that's where you and I have been. If you're a Christian, there was a point in time when you recognized your own sins, you recognized your own faults, and you owned up to them, you realized you needed a Savior, and you called out to Jesus and said, Lord, I need you. This guy was on his last few hours on this earth, but here's the Savior of the world right beside him on the cross. And he recognizes it, calls out to him. The other criminal doesn't recognize it, doesn't call out to him. Two types of individuals in the world, those who will believe in Jesus Christ and those who will not. That's the only categories we have. We have all kinds of problems with people when they talk about race relations or different nationalities and all of this. Believers, unbelievers. Comes down to the last day, that's all there is. Believers and unbelievers. One criminal on the cross, he was an unbeliever. One criminal on the cross, he was a believer. And because he is a believer, Jesus says to him, assuredly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. Boy, what a promise, huh? And you and I, we have that same promise. Jesus has told us that we have a future. You know, he went to the cross to give us a hope, to give us a hope and a future. And he pays the price for you and me, a price that we could not pay. We could not pay for our own sins. Can't do it because you have to be perfect, a perfect offering. And is there anybody in this room perfect? Is there anybody in the world perfect? No. I can pretty well guarantee it's not so. Just from my own observation, I would say absolutely not. And because I know God knows a lot more than me, and he says everybody's sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, I can tell you absolutely there's not been a perfect person except Jesus who's ever walked this earth. And so he was the only one who could pay the price for our salvation. Verses 44 through 47 says, now it was about the sixth hour, and there was darkness over all the earth until the ninth hour. Then the sun was darkened, and the veil of the temple was torn in two. And when Jesus had cried out with a loud voice, he said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Having said this, he breathed his last. So when the centurion saw what had happened, he glorified God, saying, certainly, this was a righteous man. We see Jesus hanging there. The sixth hour would have been 12 noon. And there was darkness over the earth until the ninth hour, which would have been 3 o'clock in the afternoon by their timing back then. And the sun is darkened. You know, these soldiers are pretty tough guys out there. But, you know, when things start happening outside, you're not used to seeing, it starts to shake you up a little bit. And when noon, it starts getting dark, and 3 o'clock, the sun totally looks black, it's going to shake you up. It starts to shake them up just a little bit as they start to see things that they have not seen before. And we know from other scripture, the ground starts to tremble, there's some earthquakes, and it's something that they are pretty amazed by. And Jesus, he says a lot of things on the cross. I am not sharing everyone with you here this evening, but one of the things he takes care of that's not in my passage of scripture that I think is just a precious insight into Jesus, besides forgiving those who have put him on the cross, his mother is there, and we know the Apostle John is there beside Jesus' mother, and Jesus up there on the cross, dying, you know, looks at John and says, behold your mother. Looks at his mother and says, behold your son. Basically, he says, John, you're going to take care of my mom. That's pretty amazing, isn't it? Here he is dying. He's taking care of Mary. John, it's your responsibility. And I'm sure John carried that out because the Lord had asked him to fulfill that. And you and I in our lives, sometimes he looks at us and wants us to do things. And we have to decide, are we going to carry out what the Lord is asking me to do? Am I going to be obedient to Jesus? I thought that was just such a precious scene. Jesus right there. I mean, I can't imagine the suffering he's going through, that he has experienced through the night, this, you know, the scourging. It's no wonder he couldn't carry the cross all the way out to Calvary on his own strength. He'd been up all night. He'd been beaten and scourged. You know, he'd lost a lot of blood. Physically, he was weak at that moment. But the strength that he has on the cross, forgiving folks, saving a criminal, taking care of his mother, Mary. And then at the end, when he knows the moment has been reached, and he says, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." I love that. The veil of the temple, it's torn in two. That signifies that we have access to God the Father. The veil of the temple was thick. They estimated it was about 18 inches, somewhere in that neighborhood thick. It was a thick curtain. You think about our curtains, you know, they're pretty good size. You think about one that thick. But it separated the holy place from the holiest of holies, where God's presence was represented to be. So when Jesus dies, that veil is torn in two from top to bottom. I imagine when the priests saw that, they were like, "What has happened in here?" Can you imagine something that thick torn in two from top to bottom? You're trying to figure out how it happened. It was showing you and me that we now are going to have access to the Father directly through Jesus Christ the Son. He's made that way for us. That I don't have to call Ed up and say, "Ed, would you just pray for me? I can't pray for myself." You don't have to call me up and say, "Pastor, just because you're the pastor, I need you to pray for me." Yeah, I'll pray for you if you have a need. But the greatest thing in the world is every single one of us who put our faith in Jesus Christ, we can go directly to God the Father ourselves and say, "Lord, here is my needs. Here's my life. Here's my situation." Jesus made that way on the cross of Calvary when he breathes his last. And I love what it does with the centurion. Now, he's the leader of the soldiers. You know, he's there. He sees what's happened. He's watched this whole thing unfold. And he glorifies God and says, "Certainly this was a righteous man." It impacts him. He's heard the words of Jesus. He saw the way Jesus has behaved on the cross. It's not normal behavior, I can tell you. On the cross, he's seen a lot. That's not normal. The way Jesus was up there doing the things that he was doing for you and for me. Most importantly, bearing our sins on the cross of Calvary. And so Jesus breathes his last, as far as they were concerned at that moment. Verses 50 through 56 says, "Now behold, there was a man named Joseph, a council member, a good and a just man. He had not consented to their decision. Indeed, he was from Arimathea, a city of the Jews, who himself was also waiting for the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then he took it down, wrapped it in linen, and laid it in a tomb that was hewn out of the rock, where no one had ever lain before. That day was the preparation, and the Sabbath drew near, and the women who had came with him from Galilee followed after, and they observed the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and fragrant oils, and they rested on the Sabbath according to the commandment." So Jesus has impacted people throughout his life. He's impacted a man named Joseph. This man wants to take care of the body of Jesus. And we know from other scriptures that another man named Nicodemus joins with him, and they go together. They take the body of Jesus down off of the tree, and Joseph has a tomb, a new tomb, his own tomb, and that's where they take the body of Jesus and they place it in his tomb. And those faithful women who have ministered and followed Jesus and throughout his lifetime of ministry, they are right there on the scene. You know, women of the church, I want to tell you one thing. The church can't operate without women. God's ministry has always had to have women in it. Men are important too, let me say, that we're all important. But these women, they were right there. And you know, sometimes the soldiers, they don't pay as much attention to the women. They're probably looking to find Peter and do something to him, you know. But the women, the soldiers were like, "Oh, they won't hurt us." But the women were right there. They were faithful. They were true. They followed the body of Jesus to the tomb to see where it was going to be laid. They knew where it was. And then because it was the Sabbath day coming to a close, which would have been a Friday, starting the beginning of the Sabbath, I should say, the day starting to come to a close, which our day is starting to come to a close today, they had to be back home, get ready to light their Sabbath candles. They're getting ready. It's Passover week. So they know from Friday sunset to Saturday sunset, that's the Sabbath day, the Jewish Sabbath. So during that time period, they were not going to leave or go or do anything with Jesus' body. So they go back to their homes, preparing spices, getting ready to go. And take care of the body of Jesus on that Sunday morning. And so, as we get ready to close this evening, we're going to have Isabella come. She's going to sing a song for us. And we will close just after that song. I would just ask you, once she's done, just you can just make your way home as the Lord leads you, thinking about the price that Jesus has paid for your sins and mine, and the great love that he has given each one of us, that he shows us through the sacrifice that he was so willing to make for you and for me. And it's just such a blessing. So she sings this song. I just would ask you just to meditate on that, and then go home, do a little resting, and we're going to get ready to come back on Sunday morning.
Placed on his head, he knew that he would soon be dead. He said, "Did you forget me, Father? Did you?" They nailed him to a wooden cross. Soon all the world would feel the loss of Christ the King before his hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. He hung his head and prepared to die, then lifted his face up to the sky, said, "I am coming home now, Father, to you." A reed which held his final sip was gently lifted to his lips. He drank his last and gave his soul to glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. The soldier who had used his sword to pierce the body of our Lord said, "Truly this was Jesus Christ, our Savior." He looked with fear upon his sword, then turned to face his Christ and Lord, fell to his knees crying, "Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah." Took from his head the thorny crown and wrapped him in a linen gown, then laid him down to rest inside the tomb. The holes in his hands, his feet inside, now in our hearts we know he died to save us from ourselves.